Welcome to Yung Tuition. Nice to see you all. It's officially spring now. As usual, let's continue discussing basic issues in atmospheric physics in relation to climate research over the past century that you may or may not know, but would be delighted by watching this short talk. Whether or not the climate would change depends crucially on whether or not our planet can maintain the radiation balance at the top of the atmosphere in the absence of air. The balance condition is rather simple. The incoming solar radiation should be equal to the outgoing longwave radiation called OLR. So the basic issue in my climate research is how to understand and formulate OLR in terms of water vapor distribution in the troposphere that can be regulated by the Earth, irrespective of whether or not CO2 and oxfat are around. Today, I'm going to introduce a simple climate toy. You see, I'm trying to distance myself from the notion climate model. Climate model is model, but nowadays people think climate model is something real. To demonstrate that our atmosphere can emit OLR as much as required to balance the incoming solar radiation without the surface radiation as the source at all, please like, make comments, the more the better, and subscribe, as well as activate your bell so that you wouldn't miss any new progress in my research and unexpected drama. It would appear that the YouTube algorithm is working for humans now. So, are you ready? Let's go and have fun. To facilitate my explanation, let's approximate the real atmosphere as four isothermal layers, overlaying on the condensed matter surface of the Earth, whose equilibrium temperature is 288 Kelvin. Each of the four layers has constant temperature in accordance with the US atmosphere standard. Notice that the temperature of the first layer is the same as the surface, 288 Kelvin, as shown in this diagram, because it is at a thermal equilibrium with the surface. Similar to Simpson's work in 1927, only water vapor in the troposphere is considered here because it is the dominant infrared absorber and emitter. In other words, we can omit the contribution from CO2, ozone, and oxfat as a pretty good approximation. To do so, we need to use a proper humidity for each model layer based on observations. For demonstration purpose, I simply use 0.7, 0.5, 0.3, and 0.1 for the humidity for each of the four layers as shown in this diagram. If you have more realistic and reliable values for the humidity, please replace my values by all means. Because all of the four atmospheric layers are hotter than space, which is about 4K, so they should radiate upward. In essence, each layer of this model atmosphere is an infrared source, thermally generated without the surface radiation, just as what Robbins and Ashiknas did in their early experiment. Nevertheless, except for the top layer, the atmospheric radiation from each layer can be partially absorbed by the layers above it. As a result, we cannot simply add them up to obtain the outgoing longwave radiation, or OLR. Otherwise, the OLR would be overestimated. Do you agree? Simpson solved this problem by multiplying the emission by each layer by a product of transmittance factors in the similar way how to formulate a general term in a geometrical sequences as you did in high school, namely Rn equal to E sub n Tn plus 1 multiply Tn plus 2 until n until the last layer. Although the transmittance for each layer Tn varies as the water vapor amount or the humidity does. Remember, a simple equation can be used, namely transmittance is equal to 1 minus absorptivity. In this way, transmittance can be expressed in terms of humidity too. Manabe and Withrow also borrowed Simpson's method, but their paper was poorly written with too many trivial details and empirical approximations without a proper explanation. Actually, Simpson had used his method to calculate the transmitted surface radiation at the top of the troposphere. Still, we can use this method to calculate the effective infrared emission for each layer at the top of the atmosphere, called R in this table. After that, we can simply add them up to obtain the total OLR. So far, I have also worked out this integration formula for dealing with infinity number of layers if one thinks finite isothermal layers are not good enough. Actually, I'm very good at that. I can discuss this issue in the future if you want to know more. If you are careful, you may ask, how can we describe the atmosphere radiation for each layer with the equilibrium thermal temperature? Good question. In fact, until now, there is no choice other than using the Planck law for blackbody radiation, namely E equal to epsilon multiply sigma and T to the power 4, also called Stefan-Boltzmann law. I know it's weird because no justification can be made to treat gaseous layer as a blackbody or graybody. Furthermore, do you know the Planck law for radiation seems weird too, because it doesn't specify the physical properties of the radiator except for its surface temperature. That's why I have explicitly expressed the water vapor emissivity in terms of humidity. Why? Simple. Without molecules, how could radiation occur? In general, I consider both water vapor absorption and emission are primarily determined by the humidity, apart from the Stefan-Boltzmann law. In this way, the altitude-dependent transmittance can be simply written as 1 minus absorptivity. That is how I obtained the resultant radiation R in this table for each layer, as you can see. It is very interesting to notice that the maximum R is above the surface, as shown in this curve. This implies that certain layers can emit more than other layers, given the vertical distribution of humidity. In fact, this is associated with the so-called emission layer or emission altitude that has been used by many climate researchers, including Manabe in his Nobel lecture. I will discuss this issue in the future. Although Sir Simpson made the same mistake as other climate researchers did by assuming the surface can be treated as a blackbody radiation source, his detailed description of his calculation provides some indirect evidence for why it is wrong to assume OLR is the sum of the atmospheric radiation and the transmitted surface radiation. Here is why. If you read his paper carefully, you can't miss the related details. Basically, he separated the calculated the water vapor radiation and the transmitted surface radiation at the top of the troposphere, and then compared his result with observed incoming sonar radiation as shown in this table. The water vapor upward radiation total is 0.3.3 in old unit or 218.3 in watt per meter square. Transmitted surface radiation is 0.127 in old unit or in 88.6 watt per meter square. The incoming sonar radiation, if we assume albedo is 0.3, is 0.342 in old unit, but in 238.2 watt per meter square. As you can see, the sum of the water vapor radiation and the transmitted surface radiation is 307 watt per meter square, which is significantly larger than the incoming sonar radiation, 238 watt per meter square. However, the calculated water vapor radiation, 218 watt per meter square, is closer to 238 watt per meter square. This implies that the calculated OLR by Simpson in 1927 would be more accurate without adding the transmitted surface radiation. Think about it. I hope you will find this four-layer atmospherical toy easy to play. If you could, please let your children or grandchildren to know this novel and compact climate toy built on high school physics and mathematics. I am sure they will be delighted once they find how to play it. You can find the link for this publicly shared Desmos file online so that you can use it, play it, and refine it. Have fun. Thank you for your viewing. Thank you for donation. See you next time.